We're always going to use oil, we're always going to need oil, but it should be just another commodity traded on the market, not one that determines world affairs. We need to strip oil of its strategic status. And in order to do that, we need to break oil's monopoly in the transportation sector. Because it is that monopoly that gives oil its strategic status. We can break oil's monopoly in the transportation sector through fuel choice, competition. There needs to be competition when it comes to transportation fuels. And in order to do that, cars must be platforms on which fuels can compete. That means when you drive up to the pump, you can choose how to fuel your car. Or perhaps at home, you plug it in. So very little of your driving is now being done on oil. This is how we break oil's monopoly in the transportation sector. We introduce competition in terms of transportation fuel. And we break the cartel, we break the OPEC cartel and strip oil of its strategic value.
We need to create the infrastructure for change. We need to create the infrastructure for fuel switching. And we need to immediately stop the car companies from putting another 1.5 million cars per month into the American mainstream that guzzle oil and gas.
It's going to take some very courageous thinking on the part of people and some teaching and some education of society before this paradigm shift can take place.
We have attention spans of 5 to 10 minutes, and it's very, very difficult to get our public and our policymakers focused on specific issues and specific problems. It's going to require a massive public education campaign. It needs to be bipartisan and nonpartisan. And we really need to bring together a constellation of forces, both on the left, on the right, national security hawks and environmentalists who will come together to figure out a solution to this problem. It's going to be an enormous challenge.
We haven't done it because the knife has not yet penetrated the skin. We haven't done it because we're not starving. We are not completely jobless. Our cars are not being hijacked for their gasoline. We have not done it because the car makers refuse to do it.
So what we need to do is go through each of the arguments as to why it can't be done. The car manufacturers don't have their engines certified. The public is going to have to pay another $100 per car. The fuels aren't as widely available. The fuel stations don't have the proper pumps. And we need to understand that none of those is a showstopper. That each of them can be managed if the nation has the will to address these challenges. And the truth of the matter is, and you can absolutely take this to the bank, we don't have a choice. We're going to have to take these steps. The question is, do we take them before there is not the oil we need? Or do we take it after? And after is a lot harder than before. So whether there are issues of lobbyists in Washington representing one special interest or another, or politicians who don't want to rock the boat, or constituents who don't really understand the gravity of the problem. I'm sorry, but as a nation, we have to recognize we don't have a choice. We have to create conditions under which we do. Specifically, we have fuel choice. And the way to do that is for the government to establish a very simple principle, completely consistent with the operation of an open and free market. Namely, adopt an open fuel standard as the law of the land.
That's easy to say and hard to do. It depends ultimately on leaders and the ability of our countries and our political parties to keep generating people of vision, strength, courage. I guess more than anything, that's what worries me. Can we do that?
If we become energy independent, if we become less dependent on petroleum, we will not only secure our future, we'll not only be able to accomplish our foreign policy priorities, winning the war on terrorism, stopping the proliferation of nuclear weapons, improve human rights throughout the world, but we will also be able to increase prosperity in parts of the world that are currently very poor and they are struggling to pay their oil bills. There are multiple benefits to fuel choice strategy, and it's going to be a win-win-win-win situation for entire humanity.
Fuel choice is good for everybody. It's good for people's pocketbooks. It saves them money at the pump. It's good for our economy overall. It creates jobs. It creates investment opportunities to generate fuel in this country instead of importing it from overseas. It's good for our national security. It helps reduce the flow of petrodollars to countries that don't like us, that do bad things with that money. It's good for the environment. It reduces air pollution. It's good for our health in terms of reducing contaminants in our air. So in every dimension that you look at, fuel choice is really a win-win-win-win situation for the American people and for the world at large.